Dear Muslim brother and sister, Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We were commanded by our Prophet alayhi salatu wassalam to pray in the exact manner in which he prayed, as he directed us to do in the hadith narrated by al-Bukhari, which means, pray as you have seen me pray. Many Muslims are unaware of the true description of the prayer of the Prophet alayhi salatu wassalam. This production was composed so you can hear and see for yourself the full and true description of the Prophet's prayer, and then adhere to his practice. To commence the prayer, stand up after having fulfilled all its preconditions, which are facing the direction of Kaaba, known as Al-Qibla, covering parts of the body which are mandatory to cover, known as Al-Awra, being in the state of ritual purity, being fully attentive in your heart and mind of the particular prayer which you intend to perform without uttering the intention. You should pray behind an object as high as a handspan, or directly behind a wall, a pillar, or any other similar object, as this was the proven practice of the Prophet alayhi salatu wassalam. This object is known as sutra. To start the prayer, you must say Allahu Akbar, which means Allah is the greatest. This phrase is known as Takbiratul Ihram. There is no other phrase which can replace this takbira. This takbira must be said while standing, because the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said, what means, say the takbir while standing. If you are unable to pray while standing due to illness, for example, then you should do your best to pray in any other position which is physically possible. In any case, however, you must certainly say the takbira. During this takbira, do not excessively extend the vowel, which is the A, in the middle of the word Allah. The imam leading a congregational prayer shall raise his voice while saying this takbira, so those behind him can hear it. If you are praying alone or behind an imam, you need not say this takbira loudly. However, you must move your tongue with the phrase as authentically reported. Raise your hands while saying the initial takbira. It has been authentically reported in the sunnah that you may raise your hands just before, during, or just after saying this takbira. While raising your hands, keep them spread open without cupping. Your fingers shall not be closed tight nor widely spread apart. Your fingers shall reach the level of your shoulders. This is one of the two authentic forms of raising one's hands. The other is for the fingers to reach the earlobes. You may choose either of these two forms. Raising the hands apply to both men and women. If you are unable to raise one of your hands due to a certain ailment, you should still raise the other one in order to apply as much of the sunnah as possible. Where should you place your hands after this takbirah? You should place them on your chest with the right hand over the left one. There are two forms of putting the right hand over the left one. The first is to place the right hand flat over the left hand, wrist, and arm. The second is to grab the left hand with the right hand. If you alternate between these two forms, your practice would then perfectly concur with the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wassalam. Place your hands on your chest and not on your navel, nor below it, nor above the chest. Some scholars state that you should place them between your breasts. It is not permitted to place the hands on the waist during prayer, which contradicts appropriate submissiveness to Allah. You shall always gaze at the floor in humility during prayer, lowering your head and looking to the place of your prostration, except when you are reciting a tashahud, in which case you should keep your gaze at your index finger while moving it. This will be further explained in the presentation. Dear Muslim, placing your hands on the chest and lowering your head while looking at the place of prostration reflects submissiveness before Allah the Almighty. It is also a reflection of good manners before one's Lord. You must keenly maintain this during your prayer. And remember that Allah turns His face towards the face of His slave during the prayer for as long as he does not gaze away. You must struggle to keep shaitan from distracting you during prayer. If the whispers of shaitan become too powerful, it is permitted for you to seek refuge in Allah and lightly spit 3 times to your left without emitting any spittle. Immediately after this takbirah, initiate your prayer by reciting one of the great opening supplications known as Dua al-Istiftah. The companions of the Prophet ﷺ asked him about what he says when he briefly pauses in silence after the initial takbirah. So he taught them the opening supplications of the prayer. There are various supplications you can say at the start of the prayer. It is best to alternate between them in different prayers. Among the known opening supplications is saying, سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك وتبارك اسمك وتعالى جدك ولا إله غيرك, which means, glory and praise is due to you, O Allah. Blessed is your name, lofty is your greatness, and there is no deity worthy of worship except you. Another opening supplication is, اللهم باعد بيني وبين خطاياي كما باعدت بين المشرق والمغرب, اللهم نقني من خطاياي كما ينقى الثوب الأبيض من الدنس, اللهم اغسلني من خطاياي بالماء والثلج والبرد, which means, O Allah, distance me from my sins as you have distanced the east from the west. O Allah, cleanse me from my sins as a white garment is cleansed from filth. O Allah, wash my sins away with water, snow, and hail. There are other opening supplications which were reported to have been said by the Prophet ﷺ, especially during the optional night prayers, Qiyamul Layl. For more information about these supplications and other details, you can refer to books written by scholars. A good example of such books is the one written by the great scholar Al-Albani, rahimahullah, which is titled, The Prophet's Prayer Described from Beginning to End as Though You See It. After the opening supplication, you shall take refuge in Allah from shaitan before recitation by saying, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم من همزه ونفخه ونفثه, which means, I seek the protection of Allah from the cursed Satan, from his whispering, blowing, and clammy breath. It has also been authentically reported that the Prophet ﷺ would occasionally say instead, أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم من همزه ونفخه ونفثه, which means, I seek the protection of Allah, the all-hearing, the all-knowing, from the cursed Satan, from his whispering, blowing, and clammy breath. This is only to be said before recitation at the beginning of the first rak'ah, as per the opinion of a number of scholars. Then say, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, which means, in the name of Allah, the most merciful, the most gracious. This phrase is known as Al-Basmala. The most authentic opinion of the scholars is that you must not say this phrase loudly. Then recite Surah Al-Fatiha, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, what means, no prayer is valid for those who do not recite Al-Fatiha within them. If a person is new to Islam or does not speak Arabic and cannot recite Al-Fatiha, then he may alternatively say, Subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar, wa la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah, which means, glory is due to Allah, Praise is due to Allah. There is no deity worthy of worship except Allah. Allah is the greatest. There is neither any change of condition nor any power except by the will of Allah. It is an obligation to recite Surah Al-Fatiha in both the quiet and the loud prayers, and to say Ameen after finishing its recitation, extending its vowel, the E. In the loud prayer, the word Ameen is also said loudly. After reciting Al-Fatiha, recite another chapter from the Quran, whether short or long. When you finish the recitation, pause long enough to take a breath, and then raise your hands while saying Allahu Akbar, just before bowing down into the position of ruku'. The benefit of this pause is that it marks a clear separation between the end of the recitation and the takbirah of bowing. This is the second pause reported to have been performed by the Prophet ﷺ, the first being after the initial takbirah of the prayer. There is no evidence that he paused between Al-Fatiha and the following surah. Then bow down in ruku', placing your hands firmly on your knees with your fingers spread apart while keeping the head and back level. The Prophet ﷺ used to level his back to the extent that if water were to be poured on his back, it would have settled there. While bowing in a tranquil manner, say, Subhana Rabbi al-Azim, which means, Glorified is my Lord, the Almighty. Or you can say, Subhana Rabbi al-Azim wa bihamdi, which means, Glorified is my Lord, the Almighty, and all praise is His. Both are authentic narrations. You may also add, Subbuhun Quddus, Rabbul Malaikati wal-Ruh, which means, Glory to you, most holy you are, Lord of the angels and the Holy Spirit. It has also been reported that the Prophet ﷺ said during ruku', Subhanaka Allahumma wa bihamdik, Allahumma ighfir li, which means, Glory and praise are due to you, O Allah. I beg forgiveness for my sins. The Prophet ﷺ has forbidden reciting the Qur'an during bowing or prostrating. After you complete ruku', raise your head and hands from the bowing position while saying, سَمِعَ اللَّهُ لِمَنْ حَمِدَهُ, which means, Allah hears he who thanks Him. This phrase is said whether you are leading the prayer or praying alone. When you reach the standing position, say, رَبَّنَا وَلَكَ الْحَمْدِ, which means, Our Lord, and for you is all praise. Or you can say, رَبَّنَا لَكَ الْحَمْدِ, which means, Our Lord, for you is all praise. Both are authentic narrations, one with and one without the letter wa, meaning and. You may say instead one of the following supplications, both of which are also authentic. Allahumma Rabbana wa laka alhamd, which means, O Allah, our Lord, and for you is all praise. Or, Allahumma Rabbana laka alhamd, which means, O Allah, our Lord, for you is all praise. It is preferred to add the following to any of the above supplications. مِلْ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمِلْ الْأَرْضِ وَمِلْ أَمَا شِئْتَ مِنْ شَيْءٍ بَعْدٍ, which means, the heavens, the earth, and all that which you will, in addition, are abundant with your praise. This is a magnificent way of praising Allah, which is raised by the angels to the heavens. Once in the upright position, you must remain standing for a period similar to that of your ruku', as this is an important pillar. A question arises here. Where does the person put his hands after standing up from the position of bowing? After straightening up from bowing, One should place his hands back on his chest just as they were prior to going into the bowing position. If he keeps his hands down by his sides, however, this would concur with the opinion of a group of scholars who consider this to be in accordance with the Sunnah. Go down to the floor for the position of prostration, sujood, while saying, Allahu Akbar. Another question arises here. Does a person go down into the position of sujood, placing his hands on the floor first or his knees? The scholars have differed regarding the issue whether the hands or the knees should reach the floor first. We need to know which of the two opinions concurs more with the Sunnah, because each group of scholars has substantial evidence to prove their opinion. Perhaps the sounder opinion is of those who rule that one must go down into the position of prostration, placing his hands on the floor first. It is noteworthy to say that either of the two ways is acceptable, as this is not an issue over which one should condemn those who hold a contrary opinion, because the scholars themselves have differed regarding their understanding of the relevant texts from the Sunnah. During sujood, you must allow the following 7 body parts to touch the floor: the base of the toes of the right and left feet, the right and left knees, the right and left hands flat and not cupped, and the forehead and nose, which is considered as one part for this purpose. While prostrating, you shall maintain ample distance between the following body parts in a manner that is not exaggerated: elbows and sides, abdomen and thighs, and thighs and the backside of the legs below the knees. Then say, while prostrating, Subhana Rabbi al-A'la, which means, Glorified is my Lord, the Most High. You may also say, Subhana Rabbi al-A'la wa bihamdi, which means, Glorified is my Lord, the Most High, and all praise is His. You may also add, Subbuhun Quddus, Rabbul Malaikati wa Ruh, which means, Glory to you, most holy you are, Lord of the angels and the Holy Spirit. It is also recommended to say, Subhanaka Allahumma wa bihamdik, Allahumma ighfir li, which means, Glory and praise are due to you, O Allah. I beg forgiveness for my sins. You shall then raise your head from sujood while saying, Allahu Akbar, and sit. While sitting, lay your left foot flat on the floor, sitting on it, and keep the right foot in the upright position, with its toes bent and pointing towards the direction of Qibla. Keep your hands flat on your thighs, without gaps between the fingers. This is the authentic form of sunnah for sitting between the two prostrations, which is known as al-iftirash. It is from the Sunnah to say while sitting in this position, Rabbi ighfirli, Rabbi ighfirli, which means, O my Lord, forgive me, O my Lord, forgive me. You could repeat this as many times as you wish. You may also say, Rabbi ighfirli warhamni, wajburni warfa'ni, wahdini wa'afini warzuqni, which means, O Allah, forgive me, have mercy upon me, console me, guide me, and grant me good health and sustenance. This is a great supplication which combines both the good of this life and the hereafter. To concur with the Sunnah, you shall make sitting between the two prostrations equal in duration to that of your prostration, as there are 4 pillars of prayer which you should make similar in duration. These are bowing, ruku', standing up after bowing, prostration, sujood, and sitting between the two prostrations. Now go down to the second sujood while saying Allahu Akbar, repeating the same supplications and maintaining the same position described during the first sujood. You shall then raise your head from the second sujood and sit very briefly on the floor. Then, using your hands while closed in a fist, stand up to perform the second rak'ah in the same manner described earlier. Sitting briefly after the second sujood, which is known as jilsatul istiraha, meaning the rest sitting, is also repeated after the third rak'ah in a four rak'ah prayer. After completing the second sujood of the second rak'ah, raise your head while saying Allahu Akbar and sit on the floor for tashahud. Sitting for tashahud at the end of a two rak'ah prayer shall be done in the same manner as sitting between the two prostrations in the position known as al-iftirash. You shall also sit in the same manner, al-iftirash, during the first tashahud of the three or four rak'ah prayers. While sitting for tashahud, place your left hand flat on your left knee. Place your right hand on your right thigh with your right fingers closed in a fist, except the index finger. The form of positioning the right index finger in the sunnah is to raise it, slightly curved and pointed towards the direction of qibla, while moving it during supplication. You shall also join your thumb and middle finger of the right hand forming the shape of a ring. Another form of doing this is to place your thumb tightly on the middle finger. Both these forms are reported to have been practiced by the Prophet ﷺ. While seated in this position, recite at-tahiyyat, which has many confirmed versions reported to have been said by the Prophet ﷺ. You may alternate between the different authentic versions in different prayers. The most famous version of at-tahiyyat is the one reported by Ibn Mas'ud and adopted by many scholars, in which one says, التحيات لله والصلوات والطيبات السلام عليك أيها النبي ورحمة الله وبركاته السلام علينا وعلى عباد الله الصالحين أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. Which means, glorification is for Allah. All acts of worship and good deeds are for Him. May Allah send peace, His mercy and blessings upon you, O Prophet. May peace be upon us and upon all righteous slaves of Allah. I testify that there is no deity worthy of worship except Allah. And I testify that Muhammad is his slave and messenger. There is another version of At-Tahiyyat, which was reported by Ibn Abbas, in which one says, At-Tahiyyat al-Mubarakat al-Salawat al-Tayyibat lillah. السلام عليك أيها النبي ورحمة الله وبركاته. السلام علينا وعلى عباد الله الصالحين. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمد رسول الله. Which means, blessed glorification, all acts of worship and good deeds are for Allah. May Allah send peace, His mercy, and blessings upon you, O Prophet. May peace be upon us and upon all righteous slaves of Allah. I testify that there is no deity worthy of worship except Allah. And I testify that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. After the death of the Prophet ﷺ, some of the companions started to say As-salamu ala al-Nabi, meaning peace upon the Prophet, thus addressing a person who is no longer present among them. Instead of saying As-salamu alayka ayyuha al-Nabi, as mentioned earlier, meaning peace upon you, O Prophet, which implies that you are addressing someone whom you can see. If you are praying a three or four rak'ah prayer, such as Maghrib or Isha, you shall now use your hands while closed in a fist to stand up and perform the subsequent rak'ah in the same manner described earlier. Following recitation of at-tahiyyat in a 2-rak'ah prayer, or after the last tashahhud in a 3 or 4 rak'ah prayer, add the following supplication. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. Which means, O Allah, exalt the mention of Muhammad and the family of Muhammad, just as you exalted the mention of Ibrahim and the family of Ibrahim. Verily, you are of lofty praise and majesty. O Allah, send blessings upon Muhammad and upon the family of Muhammad, just as you sent blessings upon Ibrahim and upon the family of Ibrahim. Verily, you are of lofty praise and majesty. There are many authentic variations of this supplication. It is recommended that you alternate between them in different prayers. Another variation is to say, اللهم صل على محمد وعلى أزواجه وذريته كما صليت على آل إبراهيم وبارك على محمد وعلى أزواجه وذريته كما باركت على آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. Which means, O Allah, exalt the mention of Muhammad and his wives and offsprings, just as you exalted the mention of the family of Ibrahim. O Allah, send blessings upon Muhammad and upon his wives and offsprings, just as you sent blessings upon the family of Ibrahim. Verily, you are of lofty praise and majesty. During the last tashahhud in a 3 or 4 rak'ah prayer, you shall sit in the position known as at-tawarruk. In this position, sit with your left thigh touching the floor and your left foot protruding under the right leg, raising your right foot in the upright position. You may also lay your right foot flat on the floor, instead of having it upright, as authentically reported. You shall also grab your left knee with your left hand, leaning onto it with your left arm. Place your right hand on your right thigh, closing your right fingers in a fist, except the index finger, which you shall move slightly curved and pointed towards the direction of Qibla, as you did in the first tashahhud. You shall continue to move the right index finger while supplicating until you conclude the prayer with salam. It has been reported that the Prophet ﷺ said, what means, after one of you has finished his last tashahhud, he shall seek refuge in Allah from 4 things by saying, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min adhab jahannam wa min adhab al-qabr wa min fitnati al-mahya wal-mamat وَمِن شَرِّ فِتْنَةِ الْمَسِيحِ الدَّجَّالِ. Which means, O Allah, I seek refuge in you from the punishment of hell, the torment of the grave, the tribulations of life and death, and the evil afflictions of the Antichrist. After this, you may say any supplication you wish for yourself. Many supplications have been reported to have been said by the Prophet ﷺ after the final tashahhud, such as, اللهم إني ظلمت نفسي ظلما كثيرا ولا يغفر الذنوب إلا أنت فاغفر لي مغفرة من عندك وارحمني إنك أنت الغفور الرحيم. Which means, O Allah, I have considerably wronged myself. There is none to forgive sins but you. So grant me pardon and have mercy upon me. Verily, you are most forgiving, most compassionate. The Prophet ﷺ taught this great supplication to his friend Abu Bakr radiyallahu anhu, who was the most beloved person to him among all people. When he asked the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام to teach him a supplication to say after the last tashahhud. Another authentic supplication to say before concluding the prayer is, اللهم اغفر لي ما قدمت وما أخرت وما أسررت وما أعلنت وما أسرفت وما أنت أعلم به مني أنت المقدم وأنت المؤخر لا إله إلا أنت. Which means, O Allah, forgive my former and latter sins, those which I have secretly committed and those which I have openly committed. Forgive what I have transgressed and those faults of mine of which you have better knowledge than I do. You alone can send whomever you wish to paradise, and you alone can send whomever you wish to the hellfire. There is no deity worthy of worship except you. Dear Muslim brother and sister, this was a brief description of the prayer of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. So be keen to strictly adhere to it in order to attain the great reward from Allah Almighty, because he who adheres to the sunnah of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام will attain abundant reward. Allah says what means, there has certainly been for you in the Messenger of Allah an excellent example to be followed for anyone whose hope is in Allah and the last day and who remembers Allah often.
لقد كان لكم في رسول الله أسوة حسنة لمن كان يرجو الله واليوم الآخر وذكر الله كثيرا.